Thank you. Yeah, just to say a little bit how and why we're recording them, and a little bit about the sort of ground rules we lay out, that we want to find a way to say them each time. We're recording them, which is in some way is unusual in our field of work of counseling and therapy and social work. It's often the case that, you know, there's a lot of confidentiality, there's a lot of, I guess, protection of people's identities. I've got the view, because in part doing these forums is motivated by the tragic world we live in, you know, facing, even the way we use the word death is different, and lockdown is different. So we are recording them in the sense that if someone finds them useful, we feel we want to make that contribution. So, because the people in the helping professions who are working on the physical side, doctors and nurses, they're putting their lives on the line. I think there's something, and we're very protected, counselors and therapists, social workers. So I think we should take the risk of, okay, this material is available, someone finds it useful. We want to make that contribution. The ground rules are, people don't have to share more than they want to share here. If someone wants to say a lot, they can. If someone wants to say a little, they can. We're respecting each other. I guess in a sense we're, in a sense we're giving up confidentiality, but in another sense, I guess we're maintaining confidentiality in terms of if someone, we're not going to talk about each other outside of this setting. The concept or the Pellin tool that I want to talk about today is what we call true rest. We have, over the sessions we've had, which I want to try and find a way to do sort of rolling revision on, if I can use that phrase. Some of the stuff we've looked at recently, like attraction to hurt and callousing, and evaluating in terms of hurt and purpose, contribution from hurt, pendulum, memory links. What I think was still called referrals back when you and I were sitting in the same classroom, Mary, we now call memory links. I can't remember.
Yes, it was referrals.
It was referrals, yeah, I thought so. Yeah. Referrals are how, and memory links, something we're feeling today. If we have an intense emotion about something today, and that swings that pendulum, this is sort of looking at material we've looked at over the last few weeks, Josephine. Okay, I have a reaction to something today that has emotional intensity in it, and that emotional intensity comes back from incidents in my past. So we used to use the word referral. So what happens today refers back to something else in our past, some other times in our past. The example I use routinely is Christmas. You know, when the first Christmas carols are heard in the mall or in a shop, we have an emotional reaction. That emotional reaction is because hearing the carols refers us back to other Christmases. I gave up the word referral because a lot of people objected to it, because in the helping professions and other professions, it's just got another meaning. So now, Mary, I use the word memory links. It's just exactly the same material and takes away that confusion. The concept of true rest, which is pure David Pellin, is simple. It's not complicated as some of the other tools. And I routinely use the word tools. I feel what we've got is a set of tools. It's not formula. There's no formulaic answers in this work. How that differs is a little hard to get across at first, but the simple way to look at it is what you're doing, what we do with the tool is up to us. The answer is not in me, but what I do with the tool. The tool of true rest is simply those things in our life which give us a sense of renewal, a rebirth of energy, a different perspective. True rest has been in our work right from the beginning, which is 50 years plus. True rest is the activities we can take part in, things we do, put it simply, which with some degree of sureness and confidence will give us a sense of renewal, will give us a sense of being on top of things rather than things being on top of us. In terms of material I presented recently on the pendulum, and there's a lot of the material, Josephine, that's on the website, okay? And there's lots of material on what we call the pendulum that's on the website. The pendulum is a way of understanding our mood swings, put it simply, which can be pretty powerful in this time. The pendulum is about swinging from highs to lows. Our emotions swing like a pendulum. And there's lots of diagrams, lots of material on this on the website. And also we're in the process of distributing to people who are coming to the forum. But the middle of the pendulum, we call the calm. And the calm is very close to what we call true rest. True rest is mainly the calm of the pendulum. It's maybe mainly the things that will get us into the calm of the pendulum. But it is not exclusively that. There are some extreme swings of the pendulum which are also true rest. You know, going to a Glastonbury Rock Festival and just losing ourselves in that activity. Going to a football match and cheering our heads off. Going to church and being taken up into a ecstasism that is possible within the church. That's a high, that can be extreme high, and that can be true rest. True rest is not just being calm and being still. Being calm and being still, there's a lot of it. The way we look at true rest is that we all have different ways of getting it, okay? And again, it's a tool. And a large part, really, of any Pellin therapeutic process is helping someone in their particular search for true rest. For someone, it might be gardening. For someone else, it might be walking on the beach or walking in the mountains, meditating in an ashram, praying in a church, reading, going to the theater. True rest is, there is almost any human activity might well be true rest for somebody. And often true rest takes us back and relates to something in our past, something in our childhood. It's not always the case, and I live alone now, so probably slightly less the case. But washing dishes is true rest for me. That's not going to be true rest for everybody. And that goes back to drying the dishes when my mother washed the dishes, and that's one of my first memories, really. So what true rest brings us is a strength and a power that's almost like nothing else. You know, show me someone who has within them sort of true happiness, and I'll show you someone who's good at getting true rest. Like a lot of Pellin, it has elements of common sense in it. So a lot of people know about true rest and know how to look after themselves by engaging in those activities that bring them true rest. Some of us don't. And again, it's not that it's possible right now, but I grew up in Australia. I grew up in a seaside suburb of Sydney. Swimming almost always brings me true rest. And I have a 10-minute walk through a nice park to get to the swimming pool, and I don't go. Okay. I mean, one of the ways we sabotage ourselves, one of the ways we can be drawn in to self-defeating behavior, what I called in the fourth one of these forums, attraction to hurt, is it will sabotage ourselves in getting true rest. It's really quite David Pellin's tools that are just quite simple. You know, getting true rest gives us a sense of renewal, gives us almost a base of strength from which we can go back and face the responsibilities we have to face. One of the ways we can sense the power of true rest, when someone's into something that they really, really get this, they really, really get true rest from it, they sort of want to generalize that and say, the whole world would be better if everyone meditated, did the garden, went to church, went to the theater, whatever. It's a funny insistence we can have. This works so well for me, it must work for you. And we come along, and David came along with a different point of view. No, true rest is going to be very different for very different people. And what we all need to do is find those things that will bring us true rest. It's a rather sure way of finding our strength in hard times. Maybe a sure way of surviving lockdown in London with two teenage boys. So what I'd like to do now is, if people could give their examples of what might be true rest for them.
Mary, Mary Stapleton, can you put yourself on mute? It wasn't matter. There's a little thing on the left-hand side on a laptop. I don't know what you're on. And it's got a video icon and a microphone icon. And it was fine when you were still, but when you were moving, then it makes a noise for the recording.
Oh, sorry.
No problem. Can you see it? I don't know if you're on an, are you on a laptop?
I'm on an iPad.
On an iPad. I don't know about iPads, but usually it's wherever the bar is with all the little icons, it's in usually in the corner of that.
So if I put it on mute.
Unless you want to share first. well, I'll go because I was having thoughts. I've spent 12 years living in Topanga, and lots of people have swimming pools. And just this last year, my thing's swimming, not, I can't do it in the sea, only in a swimming pool. And I do breaststroke, and I deliberately keep my head above the water so I can see the sun reflecting on the water. And that's my best true rest. That's my surefire, never fails true rest. And just recently I made friends with somebody, and she has a swimming pool, and it's a salt water one. I mean, it's a fresh water one, no chlorine. So, and she lets me go there when she's out at work. So I did more swimming last summer than I have in like probably the whole of my life. And that's really works for me. So that's my example. Did people hear that? Because it looked like it was a bit of freeze, but maybe it was on the audio, not the video. Okay, good.
It was a bit of freeze, but I heard it, almost all of it. So I'll go next, since I just said something then. So mine's just really being outside in a bit of countryside, and mostly that only works in the summertime as well. And so here I am sort of struggling with the, I don't know, legal restrictions, trying to do what I'm told, mostly only focusing on doing what keeps me actually safe and what keeps other people actually safe. But unfortunately, some of the rules just don't go with that's too complicated. So I've spent the last 3 weeks trying to find these little wriggles around how do I get to Wimbledon Common without walking through the town centre where all the people are that are too close. So I've, you know, found, okay, I drive up, and now the parking restrictions are reducing more and more and more all the time. But it means a couple of days ago, because it really got extreme, I found this other little place. I actually walked through this massive threatening sign of private property, and found that on the other side of there, there's a little place I can park. So long story short, parked there today where there's some allotments, and that led me to the back entrance to the, there's a huge park up there as well that I haven't been going in because I just assumed that will be crowded full of people, and it really wasn't at all during the week. And it's just stunning with all these rhododendrons and azaleas and everything. And finally, all my efforts to get myself into an environment where I can feel some true rest succeeded without me having to do all this really complicated trying to avoid being stopped from sitting down by motorbike cops, which I had happen, and just there's been more brain squeezing to try and find my little innocent ways of getting true rest than I've been able to get true rest. But I think I've cracked it. Long story. Thank you.
Anyone else, Victoria?
I know. I knew you would say Victoria, so I thought I'd do it voluntarily. So I have a few things to say. As always, the number one thing, Nikki and Jos and all the lucky people who live in London, where Highgate and Hampstead Heath cannot be locked, as we here in Paris. Obviously, we are like 10 times smaller, but all the parks are closed. So what I'm doing, because for me, walking in nature is also true rest that is always there and available, or actually, well, usually available. Everybody walks around the gates of the parks in a very close proximity to each other when it is allowed, meaning before 10 in the morning and after 7. So one, this is something about walking and being in nature. I wanted to say number two thing is that I personally have different true rests at different times of the day, of the season. So I have like a little toolbox of true rests. Being in nature never fails. Otherwise, I can read poetry. For me, it's also praying to have some rain, because when it rains, I don't need any excuses and I can stay at home watching the fire and reading poetry. For me, true rest can be talking to someone I really would like to share things and listen to. This type of encounters when after that you feel there was a real deep, profound touch. And this is true rest for me too, because it's human encounter. Which matters in comparison to many encounters that unfortunately are not of this nature. So for me, there are different true rests, and as Peter said, different activities. Gardening is the idea of gardening is my true rest, but when I have to garden here in my tiny garden here, and then I don't know. I think this is one of those activities is like with the swimming pools. I love the result of it, but the idea of doing it, like the idea of going and swimming in the pool, it's definitely not the true rest. So I love, true rest is to be proud of having done it. And for me recently, it became just sitting quiet and observing. Observing things, it's a really like true rest. I separate it as a pause during my day, not like a meditation pause, but just sitting and observing whatever is there to observe. And the last thing is, which is probably the most important thing, is that Dalai Lama once said, if every child starts meditating from the moment a child possibly can start meditating, so there won't be any wars, any probably, you know, dramas and tragedies like this. So for me, this is my true rest and my true refuge. And now I didn't have enough discipline for years and was doing it on and off. And this lockdown serves me a wonderful opportunity to start my day with it. And this is like my true rest. Yeah, there's something else, but I probably keep it for later. Oh, thank you.
Anybody else? Yeah, Cynthia.
I may have a bit of an unusual one, but the last several, for quite some time, for several years, I was intensively studying Japanese with a good friend of mine. And one of the things I found is doing things in Japanese, I think, is true rest almost always. And I think that might be why I'm off kilter, because I spent a lot of time watching crazy things and looking at crazy things and doing my work in English lately. But yeah, when I'm almost always, if I'm reading in Japanese or watching TV in Japanese or playing a game, it's usually common, or talking with my my good friend and Japanese study partner often makes me calm. Some other things most of the time, like gardening, well, it depends. You know, gardening, it's lovely when everything's working, but then, you know, things happen, problems happen, like your plants die and get, you know, there's a lot of issues with that. And same thing with knitting and crocheting. Most of the time, that gives me two rest until there's a problem and you make a mistake, and, you know, but most of the time, that's true rest. And sometimes taking walks, but I think for me, the probably Japanese is most consistent and most of the time with confidence. I don't know. I don't really have many other people to talk to other than my study partner. And a few times I do, talking makes me nervous if I'm not talking to somebody I'm close to. But you know, that's the same thing in English. So. I think that's about it.
Domo, domo.
I was just wondering whether Stacy or Josephine might need to ask a question, whether they instantly understand their own true rest from a brief introduction. Just wondering.
Well, I understood the true rest. I'm in true rest when I'm eating, which is a bad coping tool because it makes me fatter and it's an addiction. And when I'm practicing my addiction, I'm in true rest, but then I feel bad about it. But I'm in true rest when I'm writing stories and creating and in the mode with my creator and just feeling divine inspiration and creating a whole new world that didn't exist before. And that's what I got out of it. Because there's like total peace and a zen when I'm eating, but it's like awful when I stop. It's like, oh no, what have I done? And then the pendulum swings. And then but when I'm writing, it's like a peace and a calm and like, yeah, I'm creating with my creator or drawing.
To be honest, I'm not really sure at the moment what mine is, which is why I haven't answered. I mean, I agree with Victoria that for me, having a long conversation with a really good friend, that's something that I find puts things in perspective, I suppose, as much as anything for me. Because, I mean, my life is very much revolving around work, home, children, and I've got an elderly ill mother as well, so it feels like constantly I've got things I should be doing or planning or thinking about, and it's quite hard to find to allow myself to not concern myself with those things, I suppose. So maybe what I need to do is try and find that thing that I can, that place I can go, or that thing I can do to just recharge during the day.
Mary, do you want to come in?
Okay, I'm very fortunate. I live on the south coast of England. I've just moved into a little house with a garden from living in a flat. So I am very happy pottering in the garden, walking down to the prom, walking by the sea. I can get up on the downs if I want. It's all very peaceful and lovely and very enjoyable.
Mm.
What I've been finding is though that some days I can engage in those activities and I'm fine. Other days I just have total fatigue come all over me, and I will read all day long. Now, reading, when I used to work and I couldn't read for long periods, reading was a true rest. It was something that I could lose myself in and be very engaged in, though. But now it's like reading is a means of hiding away. I can just sort of be lost in a book and be reading wildly and almost not remember a thing I've read, you know, after a whole day of reading. So what used to be a restful thing for me is nowadays maybe a hiding place that doesn't feel restful.
Mm.
That makes sense.
Yeah, no, that makes total sense. And it's the other side. One of the assumptions of our work is that in any positive situation, there's a coat of negative. In any negative situation, there's a coat of positive. A bit like the yin yang, a slightly different approach to it, because we're not saying the code of positive around the negative and the code of negative around the polars. Positive balances themselves out, okay? You see the world slightly different, yeah.
So I have to be careful not to give myself a hard time, though, for giving in and just allowing myself to read all day.
Yeah. One way to look at it, because the code of negative around the positive of true rest is addiction. And David didn't use the word addiction, he used the word escapism. They're essentially covering the same thing, but in a further way, taking it sort of out, you know, beyond what's called substance abuse, which is, some of you know, one of my, you know, fields of work going way back. So escapism is more than substance abuse. You know, people can, I can certainly escape into news programs. It used to be newspapers, but now it's news programs on the internet, and you can get them from all over the world. And if someone asked me, you know, okay, how many hours do you spend looking at news programs? I think I would refuse to answer. It'd be too embarrassing, okay? You know, addiction. So in a sense, anything can be true rest, and a lot of things can be escapism. And, you know, addictions in the way we look at it aren't just, you know, substance abuse or food, but it could be, certainly people, and often things that start as true rest become addictions. Mm. And I guess we would describe escapism as that which takes us away from fulfilling our responsibilities. True rest moves us towards fulfilling our responsibilities. And, you know, too much television can certainly be an addiction. Yeah.
Well, I'm noticing as the examples come up and as you talk, that in something that's successfully true rest, we have a feeling of accomplishment, is my intuition. What Stacey described, or what Mary described with the incessant reading, it's lost the feeling of accomplishment, and therefore isn't refreshing.
Yeah. That, by the way, is a topic I haven't covered yet, feelings of accomplishment. Just to say it briefly, is one of the central tools in this work. We make a distinction between accomplishments themselves in an objective sense and feelings of accomplishment. You know, the feeling I'm accomplishing something is not the same as the accomplishment itself. They're different things. Someone can be, you know, a doctor could have delivered 600 babies. There won't be the same feelings of accomplishment in the 601 babies as there were in the when she was first delivering babies in her medical practice. There can be more feelings of accomplishment. We're going to be accomplishing a great deal, but there aren't necessarily feelings of accomplishment there. It's a particular part of this work. And that's what Mary was referring to there. Feelings of accomplishment is something quite special. Hasn't quite got it on a syllabus yet, and that's a bit of a mess. But there will be a, but what feelings of accomplishment are essentially we're satisfied and feel good about what we're doing. So I guess the difference between, it's complicated there. This stuff, they're very simple tools. And as I say here very frequently, because the language we both, the language we use is simple, deliberately, and the tools we develop are simple. And so I, with perhaps too much repetition, bring in what I call my heavyweight support team, that you can Google Michelangelo's tools and they will come up. And they're crude to the point of you couldn't buy them in Home Base or Home Depot. But with, and then I ask people, having Googled Michelangelo's tools, which to our eyes look very crude, then Google Pieta St. Peter's, and his masterpiece comes up. He created that masterpiece with those tools. I'm not apologizing for simple tools at all. True rest is a sort of simple tool. But what it can achieve, and how it can be applied to tough and complex situations, it's very powerful, very, very powerful. It's sort of, our method is, you know, learning, practicing and learning, certain amount of repetition in the teaching, so someone gets a feel for what this is, someone gets a feel for what the pendulum is, someone gets a feel for what true rest is. And then we bring up that tool when we need it. If things are just too much, what would it be like if I got some true rest? What would it be like if I took some time out?
Because I was just thinking, I was just having a fantasy that if you were doing couples counseling and there was a lot of fights and tension, and you said to the two people, what true rest have you had recently? Like, you quite likely found out they didn't have any resources for true rest, that just that disengaging and being absorbed in yourself and your relationship to whatever the true rest thing is, you know, the ocean, the mountains, the playing a game of tennis, it just gives you that perspective and satisfaction in the activity, and everything's not in your face so much.
Yeah, all of that. And in that particular situation you were talking about, working with a couple, not just have you had any true rest lately, but how could those two people get true rest together? Have they ever got true rest together? Even if they're on the brink of, things going very wrong, can they remember times when they got true rest together? That can be very powerful. Supporting someone in getting true rest can be very powerful. What you'll often find, and I've been there myself, couples who are having trouble, a marriage that's having trouble, they'll tend to sabotage the other person's true rest as well as their own. One of the ways, what in our field of work we call goodwill, which is people's ability to consider change, when we get nasty towards each other, we find ways to sabotage the other person's true rest. It's a tip off that things are in trouble. And the reverse, of course, of that is true. A happy marriage will be two people who are supporting each other getting true rest, that's for sure. Any other examples, sharings we could do? I want to share one thing that I'm just a bit intrigued about, because I've set myself a lot of ambitions recently, and there's a fair bit of stress around, let alone what's happened. And when you were talking about the Japanese, I've got all sorts of connections with Italy, some of you know, and I've had those connections for 50 years, almost. I've not learnt the language. I sort of get by, and it's southern Italy where people are very tolerant. But I think if I sat down and just did a little bit of Italian, I love Italy, I'm, very love my life. And my connections are in the south of Italy, which is quite a special place. The logo, by the way, is of a diving man. That's a logo on a lot of our work. And that's a fresco, Greek fresco, 2500, from Greek ruins near where my work in Italy is located, a place called Pestum. The diver is the Pestum diver. That's why he's up there, because of my connection to Italy. And I think if I just did a little bit of Italian every day, not from the point of learning Italian, but from the point of view of getting true rest, I think it could really work for me. I've been around the language all those years. I think it could really bring me some true rest. Because sometimes we need something that can be true rest at some time of our life. And it's still an important activity, but it's not quite true rest anymore. Yes, I think a lot of people who go to the gym, which I try to do, it's not very much for a lot of people. I'm not saying for everyone, but for some people, okay. There's satisfactions in it, it's not quite a chore, but it's really not quite true rest, the way it was once. And that's, I guess that's where I grabbed onto the bit. Ooh, what would it be like if I spent 15 minutes a day on Italian? It's the freshness of it. And that's an odd, I'm saying it's fresh, even though I've been around all those years, but a true rest activity, it would be really fresh. Have we lost Mary because of the internet? Wonder.
I think she sent us an email before warning about the problems with Wi-Fi.
Yeah, because Cynthia has the hosting of the thing, of the Zoom. But I think Mary's having trouble with internet connection down there.
Peter, can I ask a question?
Yeah.
What does Pellin say about the ways in which we stop ourselves from doing 15 minutes of Italian a day, or in my case, learning the guitar? I know that if I give a bit of time to it and I commit myself to it for a while and I have that consistency, I can start to really enjoy plunking away on the guitar.
Yeah.
But I stop myself. The voices in my head go, oh no, I can't be bothered. Oh, it's so dreary. I'll never be any good at it. You know, what's the point? And so I don't.
Yeah, and no. That,
yeah.
And I could sort of run that litany about me in Italian, because
you can
mom, I'm sure. I'm embarrassed to say this, but I'm sure you could remember me probably saying the same thing 25 years ago. Okay. So the bit in terms of, you know, answering your question, what Pellin has to say, it's the part of the work that is attraction to hurt and also what we call resistance to
nourishing change.
Yeah, that's further down the line. But generally speaking, putting those particular tools, demanding tools, into a into more straightforward language at this time. We all have our own sort of stuck places. We all have our own self-destructive behavior. We call it resistance to nourishing change and attraction to hurt. We are attracted in a way to not doing as well as we could, part of human nature. So
Julia Cameron talks about getting rid of the inner critic by writing free verse 3 pages a day. And then no matter what your inner critic says, it doesn't matter. You just write it down.
Yeah. So
there's no way to do the free pages wrong.
Yeah.
And that unblocks you from the inner critic. It teaches you to ignore it. That's what I do to unblock when I can't write.
Yeah. Yeah, that's sort of similar. We've got similar things that approach that, which
I have a question.
Yeah.
So, but maybe then not doing Italian, because I know you since 94. That's when you mentioned first you wanted to learn Italian, but maybe not learning it is part of the true rest for you as well, because thinking what you have to do when you have to learn it, and like Mary practicing guitar, like I have my own things, like I think, well, gosh, 15 minutes a day, that's possible. And then maybe I start thinking, doing lots of loving kindness to myself, maybe my true rest is just thinking, gosh, I could have done it today, but I didn't do. I did other things. So this is sort of part of my question or sharing. Because, you know, like if it's been going like this for so many years, there must be something apart from attraction to nourishing change. Maybe because when you go there without Italian, the way you connect to people, and I saw you with Liberato, is such a different and wonderful connection as well. How they understand you without you speaking Italian. So that's what part of my sort of loving kindness true rest thing is telling me as well. You know, I think, well, gosh, doing like real sport 10 minutes a day, because you can do it, you'll be strong and beautiful and aging gracefully. And then I think, no. And then each day I think, oh, just 10 minutes. And then instead I go for a walk. So this is my question. Maybe part of the true rest, there's some benefits, some silver linings that these things are bringing us for not doing what we think is it's just an open question.
Yeah, I would, I would really agree with that. And I think it's,
do you like to hear how Paris says thank you to the doctors? I think to try and bring you
there. For people who weren't here before, this is Victoria taking part in everyone clapping and beating pots and pans for the doctors and nurses in Paris. Oh, thank you, Victoria. That's great.
I have to hang up and call straight back in a minute.
Okay. Cynthia. You're going to say something.
Yes, a couple of things. One, just a housekeeping. I did just hear from, I just heard through Mary, through somebody else, she did, her internet connection did cut out, and she'll come back in as soon as she can get in.
Okay.
And just a couple more things. One of the things you were talking about, something that used to be free rest, true rest isn't, and it used to be when I was, my past career was a divorce lawyer. So, and then doing astrology was true rest. And now that's what I'm doing for a living. And I still enjoy it and it's good, but it's not true rest anymore. And just a thing with learning Italian and learning languages, it's learning Japanese was not true rest and is not true rest. It's stressful, it's hard work. Doing things in Japanese, once I got to a point where I could do things in Japanese, where I can listen, and which you can actually do a lot earlier than you think you can, that's true rest. But yeah, studying I needed to study to get to that point, but so that's just my own experience.
Yeah, when I felt that doing a bit of Italian every day, and I felt really casual about it, and probably to the point where I am now and the amount of time I've been in this particular part of Italy, and I like them, they like me, and we go back a long way. I guess I'm not approaching you from a, I should do this, or this would be good for Pellin. You know, I can do all the things I need to do in Italy with as much language as I got and the people I got, and that's easy. It'd be almost sort of mischievous, or, you know, maybe I'd enjoy learning words I'd never use. I don't know. There's a lightness to it. And I guess, I think there has to be a lightness about true rest, although it's paradoxical. It also has to be deeply serious. So, but there has to be an element of lightness in it. And I think when things go from true rest to being work, more responsibility, even at times to the point of being a chore, well, then they've lost their lightness. And I guess what we're saying with that, and coming back to Victoria's point, I think it's something about, there's something in true rest where we really are loving ourselves. You know, we are doing that. You know, and when, if someone's true rest is the beach or the theater or the gym, they walk in feeling good. You know, they walk into that place and feel good. So there are tip-offs to what true rest needs to be. But the method, Pellin method, is to sort of grasp the tool and find a way that it can be useful to you, or if it can be useful to you. And you know, one of the things we say, which is on the one hand very radical, but on the other hand just sort of obvious and common sense, not getting true rest is a cause of mental illness. It's that simple. And there's a solution to some mental illness, so-called, in people getting true rest. And it's something very characteristic of David Pellin's material, is that it's really safe. You know, it's really, you don't have to worry about experimenting and using it, because the worst, it'll be benign. It's not going to cause anyone any harm. It's not of the nature of putting false diagnosis on people or an accurate diagnosis on people. It's got a very, very different methodology. And the methodology is grasping the tools and see where we can go with it.
I think perhaps I should just give my guitar away.
Wow.
It makes
well,
me feel
well, that's drastic.
Yeah.
But maybe giving it away to somewhere where you can get it back if one day you feel the craving or longing for it, so that it's...
Yeah. I'll put it in the attic.
Yeah.
No, that wouldn't help. Attic has a very particular symbolic meaning in the house, so don't put it in the attic if you made a decision to give it away, because then it's not given away, it's even above you.
Yes, yeah, sitting there glowering at me.
I just wanted to say one thing about true rest as well, as if can I?
Mm.
So I think, like you said, you have to feel light getting in. It's exactly the point, like when I go to the swimming pool, I don't want to swim, but I want to have done it. So for me, it's, you know, to be proud that I've done some physical activity. So this is not true rest. And now you just really put the point, it's like really pinpointing it. And also for me, true rest is where I can use the word enjoy, basically entering the joy.
Mm.
So like if learning a language is a hard work, but then using it or something around it is enjoyment, so for me then the process of learning the language would not be a true rest, but then the result of the using it or the pride when you get out of the swimming pool or whatever, then this is the true rest. Well, I married an Italian to learn the language, and we speak all the languages apart from Italian. So even that didn't help, but I speak it now. So, and this is just enjoyment. This is part of the definition of true rest for me from the very beginning.
Yeah. And that's where, again, we talk about tools and in individual difference. Over and over again, we talk about tools and individual difference, because you're saying that's for you, it needs to have those qualities, okay? But for someone else, you know, true rest might be extreme hiking, which is risky, painful, and not joyful in that sense. So what we've got with this method, it's the, because I'm, Mary, I'm recently wanting to develop something directly for the coronavirus times about out from the Pellin tools. And I'm calling it the Pellin lift. So the tools can give you a lift. You know, something.
Yeah.
The tools can lift somebody up. And that's where, again, we've got the individuality, individuality and the different uses of a tool. Because certainly someone's true rest won't be like yours, Victoria. It'll be quite different. And, you know, knowing the, because of my kids in British Columbia, Canada, you know, extreme sports, extreme swings, hiking, you know, the sort of painful, life-threatening activity that a whole population there gets into.
Enjoy it when they do it? My question is, if enjoyment is the component, like general, for different things, well, but do then we enjoy doing it?
Yeah, then it's a question of the words, isn't it? Mm. Because I know there's something particular, and it's called the grass grind. There's a famous mountain outside of Vancouver called Grass Mountain. And the grind, and my son-in-law does it, is sort of just going up this mountain, jogging up this mountain. It's agonizing, okay? So it's a question that's sort of, I don't want to be semantic, but how do we define the word enjoy? Because I think that would have to be individually defined. Cynthia.
I was also thinking of something, you know, when we're talking about the different languages and with Japanese, and actually there's a couple things. One, I had a lot of trauma growing up. I mean, I grew up in a really crazy household with, and, you know, so when I was, you know, learning English or, you know, that stuff, you know, there's a lot of scary memories and stuff. But when I learned Japanese, it was with a real dear friend who I was real close to. And but one of the things that, and so I think I have different, it's strange because when I switch languages, I have almost like a completely different set of memory links involved with it. But one of the things I've done because of that, and I didn't know anything, but I've been very intentional about protecting Japanese. Like, even though it would be better for my Japanese if I read the news in Japanese, I don't. And I make sure that, you know, even with my friend, if I'm going to have a difficult conversation, we switch to English, so that I've sort of had this like cordoned off. And that was something I just sort of instinctively did. I don't know if that's something in terms of protecting your true rest.
Yeah, I think so, because at our best, we will protect the true rest, okay? I think I do that because I get a lot of true rest out of reading. It can go over to the point where, you know, am I running away from things by reading or not? But in the main, I'm aware that I really protect that, okay? I really protect the way I get true rest from reading. Like if I've read too much of something, I'll drop it. And, yeah, I read a lot of history, and I've recently read a lot of history, a bit compulsively, about the Second World War. And then it was a time for me to let go of that. Yeah. Victoria?
Sorry, I wrote in the chat a message. Thank you to everyone. I would like to go and get some true rest because now we're allowed to get out of the houses and walk outside. So I will do it because then, sorry.
Yeah.
And
see. Okay. Thank you. Okay, bye-bye. Bye-bye. It's extraordinarily powerful. And I think it's useful to sort of think about it a lot because we tend not to. And share it with other people. Certainly it's an addition to the whole concept of psychotherapy or counseling. Of being able to say to someone, okay, what true rest do you get? And this is, what activities do you engage in that bring you back to your strength, bring you back to yourself? Nikki?
It isn't something that...
Sorry, Mary. Go on.
It isn't something that I can just allow myself to fall into, though. I think I'm realizing that to have that true rest, it has to be a deliberate choice of activity or non-activity or whatever that I am doing with thoughtfulness.
I think so, yeah. I think for many of us that that's a necessary part of it. A really necessary part of it. Some people luck out and they're just sort of there, they do it automatically. But because of what we call common sense, but we don't all have common sense. We've got our particular bits of it. I said to a friend of mine recently, he's very disciplined. He's just finishing a PhD and he's in China finishing this PhD. And I said, Chris, if I had your self-discipline, I might be famous. And he came back and said, yes, but if you had my smoking and drinking habits, you wouldn't be healthy, okay? So, none of us have got it all, right? So I think some people almost luck out on true rest, the same as some people luck out on purpose. It's sort of almost born into them. That was a bit true for me about purpose. I had no trouble with David Pellin's material on purpose. It just sort of slotted in. I think I got it from my dad in some way. The pendulum, another question. I'm still working on my pendulum. Mary, I've trained people to think, well, yeah, I understand about the pendulum, Peter, but it doesn't really mean much to me. We're
different. That's me.
Yeah. So some of us need to make the search for true rest and the decision and delineation of what will be true rest for us very, very deliberate.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I think that's true. And I think I'm like that. I kid myself if I don't do that.
I just had an idea, Mary. It might be completely crazy, but just with you saying, I'll get rid of the guitar, you know, put myself out of this agony. And and it jumped into my head, well, what if you got a ukulele? Because they're just such a exactly such a comedy instrument. Would it solve the problem? Because it's like, well, I can't take this seriously. I'll just play the wretched little thing.
Funnily enough, that is a thought I've had as well, Nicola. So maybe there's something in it.
Wow. Find someone who'll do a swap, a guitar for a ukulele.
Yeah.
Yes, definitely. Good idea.
This has helped me to realise this sort of excruciating squeezing, or feeling squeezed by the rules and regs, and, you know, trying to understand the rules and regs. Because it's all about the squeezing for me. It's about all these narrow little ways of me trying to find a way through to be able to get my source of true rest. That's what it's actually been about. That how do I get onto the common with my journal, really, which is, you know, easy if I've got the car and be up there long enough, and then ideally take my flask of tea. I think that's been a lot of this restriction of the parking opportunities there, and then finding the non-town centre route for walking up there. The footbridge is shut across the railway line, so just squeezed in every way. So anyway, I've said it before, but it was just amazing to me today that suddenly I found, oh wow, Canada's Arrow Park is not full of people, and I found this little trick of a place to park for the time being until they ban that as well. So, and then there were even benches and picnic tables. I mean, I don't understand how they haven't taped all those off. So now I've got another little plan to take washing up liquid in a bottle up there to be able to wash a table and sit at a table, and then it's like normal life is resumed. Crikey. Until somebody else tells me off again.
Okay, we finish up Mary like a Pellin round. Okay. But just again, in the spirit of this, sort of saying our names and where we're located, and anything else we want to say about this particular forum. And I'll go first, then I'll call on people. It makes it easier, I think. I'm Peter. I'm in King's Lynn, the east of England. I'm getting more comfortable with this, and at the same time, I'm struggling with how do I best get the material across? Something like that. Yeah, that's me. Do you want to go next, Nikki?
Okay, yep. I just remembered the other true rest thing that I just never think of. It's watching dogs enjoying themselves. So that's another thing I get from being in parks, which I had all sorts of different experiences of that today. But of course, I'm not allowed to touch dogs now as well. That's the other thing. But it's all right. I don't mind and they don't mind, but I still get to look at them. So that's me for today.
Mary?
I'm in Eastbourne on the south coast. I moved house on March the 6th. So the first few weeks of all this happening. I've been very busy settling in to a new house. So it's only in the sort of like last week or two that I have started to feel the strangeness of life now. I don't have the busyness to distract me that I had in, you know, the first few weeks. And I have found myself going up and down. You know, when I wake up in the morning, I don't know what each day is going to bring. I'm so pleased that we've had nice weather and been able to just be out in the garden, really, and pottering in the garden, and that has been my greatest peace of mind. And allowing myself to be whatever I am each day.
Stacey?
Okay, hi, I'm Stacey. I'm in Las Vegas, Nevada. And besides eating and writing and drawing, I like playing with my dog. He's good for about two throws because he's the laziest dog in Las Vegas, Nevada. But he will chase his toys for two throws. His name's Bailey. Thanks.
Yeah.
Peter.
Cynthia.
Hi, I'm Cynthia. I'm in Kankakee, Illinois, which is a little bit south, about 40 or so minutes south of Chicago. One thing that today I've been thinking about, and it's occurred to me, because I've been very off kilter, which has been very, you know, through this whole time, which is very sick, because I work at home, but my spouse is home too, because she has to work at home now, because, you know, where she is closed. But one of the things I think that it's been much harder, and I feel bad because it's like, you know, so many people lost their jobs. You know, I'm grateful that she's here. We get along very well. And, you know, so I feel bad feeling complaining and stuff about it. But I think what's happening is it's hard for me to get free rest. It's true rest. It's hard for me. And it's also hard for me to do my my usual routine, because now I've got to work around somebody where I didn't have to do that before. I mean, and like I said, I felt bad because I'm like, well, why am I complaining about all these things that, you know, everybody's healthy? But I think that it might be that just the finding new ways to get true rest in this circumstance that maybe, you know, might be helpful.
Okay. Well, thank you for coming. It's lovely to see you, Mary, really. Hope you come back. And we'll be doing this again on Sunday. Okay?
Okay.
And yep. Sunday, I think we're doing what I call advisors, which is how other people help us solve problems and protect and enhance our life. Okay, bye-bye.
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 Bye.
Thank you, Cynthia.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.